darkness you give hope, you restore every heart that is broken.
Check, check. Check one, check two. Check, check one, two. Are we good? Can you hear me? Can y'all hear me out there? Can y'all hear me this morning? All right, well, it is so good to be with you all today. Thank you for joining us, whether you're outside or online or in your car. Hey, we got anyone in the car? There we go. Y'all left me hanging last time. Man, it's so good to be worshiping with you wherever you're at this morning. So thank you so much for joining us. It has been requested that we have a moment of silence for FSU football. But we are not going to do that. We are talking about prayer today, and I don't know if that'll come up, but I know there's a lot of folks in Tallahassee praying really hard right now. So anyway, hey, a couple things real quick, especially if you're here on campus outside. I do want to let you know that we've got some lyric sheets right over here on the table, if you haven't picked that up yet. And if you're online, you can also get those lyric sheets as well, and I'll help you through the music that we're going to be singing today. You can get that on YouTube or the website. Also want to let you know the offering basket for those of you who are here on the table back there as well. And if you do have little ones, if we got any kids here, we've got some kids sheets for them back there as well. That's all I've got for us this morning. So as we prepare our hearts for worship today, wherever you're at and wherever you're tuning in, would you go ahead and stand up and let's pray together this morning. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you for the opportunity to gather here. God, we thank you for your presence is not bound by any location, God. We don't have to be inside a building. We don't have to be in a specific place, God. Wherever your people gather, there you are. And so, God, we thank you for the promise of your presence in this place. God, we thank you that every home is now a satellite campus, God, of your presence. Father, I pray wherever people are gathered, wherever people are watching, wherever people are worshiping, God, that your presence would fall in tangible ways. Holy Spirit, we love you. We bless you. Come and fill this place. All honor and glory is yours. In Jesus' name we pray. And all God's people said, amen.
All right, come on, let's lift our voice this morning. We're going to sing Water You Turned Into Wine.
Water you turned into wine, open the eyes of the blind, there's no one like you, there's none like you. Into the darkness you shine, out of the ashes we rise, there's no one like you, there's none like you.
Come on, we sing our God.
Our God is greater, our God is stronger, God, you are higher than any other. Our God is healer, awesome in power, our God. Our God.
Come on, we're going to sing into the darkness again.
Into the darkness you shine, out of the ashes we rise, there's no one like you, there's none like you.
Come on, our God.
Our God is greater, our God is stronger, God, you are higher than any other. Our God is healer, awesome in power, our God, 'cause our God is greater, our God is stronger, God, you are higher than any other. Our God is healer, awesome in power, our God, 'cause our God.
Come on, let's lift our voices and sing, and if our God.
And if our God is for us, then who could ever stop us? And if our God is with us, then what could stand against? And if our God is for us, then who could ever stop us? And if our God is with us, then what could stand against? Then what could stand against?
Come on, let's sing.
Our God is greater, our God is stronger. God, you are higher than any other. Our God is healer, awesome in power, our God. 'Cause our God is greater, our God is stronger. God, you are higher than any other. Our God is healer, awesome in power, our God. And if our God is for us, then who could ever stop us? And if our God is with us, then what could stand against? And if our God is for us, then who could ever stop us? And if our God is with us, then what could stand against? Then what could stand against?
Let's sing this chorus again. Let's lift our voice.
Our God is greater, our God is stronger. God, you are higher than any other. Our God is healer, awesome in power, our God. 'Cause our God is greater, our God is stronger. God, you are higher than any other. Our God is healer, awesome in power, our God. 'Cause our God.
Amen. All right, you guys might not know this next song, but that's okay. I'm just kidding. Sorry, if I'm tugging on my face mask up here, it's because I think I'm an FSU defender. Sorry. All right, it's more comfortable. Come on, let's lift our voice in praise. This is such a great song that we can sing it now. We can sing it in the future. We've sung it in the past. Let's sing about the grace that is our God.
Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now I'm found. Was blind, but now I see. 'Twas grace that taught my heart to fear and pierce my fears, relieved. How precious did that grace appear the hour I first believed. Through many days tools and snares I have already come. 'Tis grace has brought me safe thus far, and grace will lead me home. And the Lord has promised good to me, his word, my hope secure. He will my shield and portion be as long this flesh and heart may fail, and mortal life shall cease, I shall possess within the veil a life of joy and peace.
Come on, let's sing Amazing Grace.
Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now I'm found. Was blind, but now I see.
Once lost.
And I once was lost, but now I'm found. Was blind, but now I see.
And thank you, God, for helping us see. To see your goodness, your grace, and your mercy. That grace that is amazing, Lord. That we sing for the joy and the hope. When times are hopeless, when times are lost, your name rings true, Lord. And we give you grace, honor, and glory, all to the name of our King, Jesus Christ. Amen.
Amen. You may be seated. We want to welcome you to worship, and this is the time that we set aside in our service to give praise to God for all the ways that he has just poured out grace upon us, and he has blessed us in so many ways. And first of all, we just want to give God praise for the team that went for the ramp build recently. They went to someone in our community, build a ramp, spent all day doing that. They have done that several times recently, and we just want to give God praise for the blessing of being part of that. Thank you. But this is also our opportunity to give back to God, not only in gifts of service, but also gifts of our tithes and offerings. We want to remind you that as Jay sings in a few minutes, if you feel led to bring your offering there to the table, there is a box there on the table. But let's just give God praise. Let's just open in a word of prayer. Father God, we come before you this morning, Lord, and we praise you for all of your many blessings. Lord, we thank you for all the ways that you have just made yourself known to us, Lord. The ways that you have provided for us, guided us, Lord, cared for us, Father, and we just honor you today. And Father, as we bring to you our gifts, Lord, we just pray that you would bless those gifts, Lord. We pray that they would be a blessing to others. And Father, as we bring our gifts of service to you as well, Lord, as we go about our day, Lord, as we interact with people, Lord, I pray that you would just help us to be a light in our community. And Father, may all the glory and all the honor be to you. In Jesus' mighty name, who taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
If you guys feel led to bring an offering up to the basket, you can go ahead and do so.
Thank you.
Why don't you guys go ahead and stand with me, and we're going to sing the doxology here.
Praise God, from whom all blessings flow. Praise Father, Spirit, here below. Praise Him above, ye heavenly host. Praise Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. Amen.
You guys can be seated.
Have to do because when we try and do, we always get second, but God always gets first, and He wants to celebrate with us. So that's my message for you guys this morning. Thanks. Hopefully that was a little better than a flower pot. But if you would pray with me now. Father God, we thank you for who you are, the God that you are, Lord, the fact that you do want us to share in your glory, that we don't have to do anything, we don't have to try harder or do more. And no matter how bad we feel, how much we fail, God, you love us more and more each and every day. We thank you and we praise you. In your Son's name we pray. Amen.
Nick, you're getting really good at this, man. I think we want to see you do it more often. How do y'all feel about that? You think Nick... the animosity I'm feeling right now. Nick, you're awesome, man. And that actually reminded me of, I believe the prayer is from Thomas Merton. And he says, Lord, I have no idea what I'm doing, and I have no idea where I'm going, but I know this, the desire to please you does in fact please you. You know, and sometimes that's all we have to bring to God, is our desire to please him. We don't know what we're doing, we don't know where we're going, we don't know how it's going to work out. And thankfully, by the grace of God, in Jesus' economy, that is more than enough. And so thank you for joining us all here today. Our scripture reading is going to come from Matthew chapter 26, 36 through 46. Easy to remember, right? Matthew 26, verses 36 through 46. So would you hear these words? Then Jesus went with them to a place called Gethsemane, and he said to his disciples, sit here while I go over there and pray. And taking with him Peter and the two sons of Zebedee, James and John, he began to be sorrowful and very troubled. And he said to them, my soul is sorrowful even to the point of death. Remain here and keep watch with me. And going a little further, he fell on his face and prayed, saying, my Father, if it's possible, let this cup pass from me. Nevertheless, not as I will, but as you will. He came to the disciples and found them sleeping. And he said to Peter, so you could not watch with me for just 1 hour? Watch and pray that you may not enter into temptation. The spirit may be willing, but the flesh is weak. Again, for a second time, he went away and prayed. My Father, if this cannot pass unless I drink it, your will be done. Again, he came them and found them sleeping, for their eyes were heavy. So leaving them again, he went and prayed for a third time, saying the same words. And he came to the disciples and said to them, sleep and take your rest later on. See, the hour is at hand. The Son of Man is to be betrayed into the hands of sinners. Rise. Let us be going. See, my betrayer is at hand. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you for the gift of your word. Lord, we thank you for the opportunity to gather both online and outside. God, we thank you, Father, that your presence is not bound by buildings. God, but your presence is here with us right now, wherever here is. And so, Father, as we get into your word, we pray that your word would get into us. God, we don't want you to conform to us. We want to be conformed into more and more into the likeness of your Son. And so we thank you, Father. Would your word here help us to connect deeply with who you are and who you are calling us to be. In the name of the Father and of the Son and the Holy Spirit, we pray. And all God's people said, amen. All right. One of the things that it would be good for us to remember whenever you're reading the scriptures, whenever we spend time in the scriptures, one of the things we want to remember is that the Bible was not written to us. The Bible was not written to you. The Bible was not written to me. That's not how it works. The Bible was not written to us. It was written for us, but it was not written to us. And by that, what we're saying is the Bible has a very, very different culture and context than we might be familiar with it. And if we are going to truly understand what the words are getting at, we got to understand that their context and their culture is different than ours. If we go applying, 21st century Western American culture to the scriptures are going to say a lot of things, but they're probably not going to say what the original authors had any intention of them saying. The Bible was written for us, but it wasn't written to us. And one of the ways that we see, one of the differences we see is in what a name means. Everybody here has a name. You've all met people who have names. But chances are when we meet somebody or we go to a place, we don't really necessarily think about the etymology of that word. We don't think about, that person, his name is Bobby. I wonder what the root word of Bobby is. I wonder what the historical meaning of the word Bobby is. Now maybe we'll get into some family stuff. I don't know if you have any family names passed down. My middle name is Holcomb. It's English. It goes way back. We actually got a castle somewhere in England. My grandpa is got the name Holcomb. My six-year-old Levi, his middle name is Holcomb. That's been a name we've passed down. We'll do that stuff, but very often we don't think so much about the meaning of a name. That's important because when we're reading the scriptures, while it may not be a big thing to us, it is a huge thing in the scriptures. Names have meaning. They don't just point to a person. They actually have something to them, more to them than just identifying this name belongs to this person. And so is the same with places, okay? So when we hear the word Gethsemane, a lot of us just said, okay, Jesus went to a park, he went to a garden, it's called Gethsemane, and he went there. Thing is, Jesus could have gone anywhere, but he didn't go anywhere. He went to Gethsemane. And Gethsemane means oil press. It means pressure. It means pressing. It means crushing. An oil press, you know, olive oil comes from, you guessed it, olives. You're incredibly intelligent people. But the thing is, olives just don't give their oil away. They must be crushed. They must be pressed. There's a pressing. There's a pressure involved to get the oil released. And so of all the places Jesus was going to go, he went to the garden that's called the place of pressing, the place of pressure, the place of crushing. And when you think about that location, in light of everywhere else Jesus could have gone, suddenly the story starts taking on some additional meaning. Think about where Jesus was before this. Right before this, if you were to read the earlier parts of Matthew chapter 26, where was Jesus right before the garden? It was the Last Supper. Probably the most intimate, meaningful, powerful dinner that's ever been held before. I mean, just incredible. I mean, Jesus is there with his friends, with his family, with his closest disciples. I mean, the people he loves. And he knows where this is leading. He knows what's on the other side of this. And so this is the night when he gathers and they're celebrating what festival? They're celebrating the Passover, where they remember how God rescued them, redeemed them, saved them from Egypt by the blood of the Lamb. They're remembering that, and they share a meal, and that's the meal when Jesus takes the bread and he blesses it and breaks it. It's the meal when he takes the cup and he says, this is my blood shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. That all happened right before this moment. Now I want you to think about what's on the other side of it. You've got the most beautiful, intimate, powerful meal that's probably ever been held and will ever be had. And then you've got the betrayal of Judas. You've got the denial of Peter. You've got the abandonment of all the disciples who were just there at the feast with them. When he said, this is my bread, this is my body broken for you. When he gave the cup, this is my blood shed for you. All them running, abandoning. And it's ultimately going to lead to his betrayal, arrest, and crucifixion. Jesus is in the midst of incredible pressure. He's between the most beautiful moment, but it was still powerful and rich with difficulty and hardship, and he's between what he knows is coming his way, the pressing of the crucifixion. He's right there in the place of pressing, so it's not a coincidence that of all the places he could have gone, wedged in between the Last Supper and the crucifixion, he goes to a place called Gethsemane, to the place of pressing. But don't miss this. He doesn't go there simply because he's being pressed. He goes there to press in. When Jesus gets to the place of pressure, it's an acknowledgement of what's going around him. But more importantly, think about what Jesus is going to do in Gethsemane. In Gethsemane, in the place of pressing, in the place of pressure, in the place of being crushed, Jesus is going to press into God through prayer. He's going to Gethsemane not simply as an acknowledgement of what's happening around him. He's going to Gethsemane as a symbolic representation of what it means to press into God. Does anyone else feel like that 2020 has become our Gethsemane? Has become our place of pressure, of pressing, of crushing? If it is that, if this is our season of pressing, if this is our season of being crushed, if this is our season of pressure, if 2020 is our Gethsemane, then it can't be our Gethsemane only in what's happening to us. It's got to be our Gethsemane the way it was for Jesus, not simply an acknowledgement of the pressure around him, but his desire to press into God through prayer. We have a sports saying. Pastor John Tyson up in New York City pointed this out the other day. We have a saying in sports where we play the clock, right? And what we mean by that when we say play the clock is if you're playing basketball and you do the tip-off, you don't do the tip-off and take the half-court shot. Can you imagine that? Tip-off, get the ball, just turn and shoot. You don't do that. Why? You save the half-court shot for win. For right before halftime, right before the end of the game, when you're down by a couple and that's all you've got left. we play the clock. In football, on the second drive of the game, you don't do the Hail Mary. That's not how you play the game. You don't gather the team up and say, all right, everyone go stand in the end zone. We're just going to see what happens. Not 2 minutes in, maybe with 30 seconds left, but not 2 minutes in. We play the clock. Well, here's the thing. In life, life is more than sport. Some of us are really feeling that right now after FSU's game yesterday. Thank goodness. Amen, right? Life is more than sport. We don't play the clock. We pray the clock. We don't play the clock. We pray the clock. Pressing times call for pressing prayers. Pressing times call for pressing prayers. And so the question then becomes, are we going to be a people who press in to the pressure of the moment, or are we going to be a people who only acknowledge that the moment is filled with pressure? Jesus acknowledged both. By going into Gethsemane, it was an acknowledgement. Yeah, there is a lot going on. Yes, there is pressure right now. But he didn't simply acknowledge the pressure for what it was. He began to press into God through prayer. Are we going to be a people who simply acknowledge that there's pressure? Or are we going to be a people in response to that pressure who begin to press into God? I want you to think about this, all right? Because Jesus knows what's on the other side of Gethsemane. And I want you to think about what he asked the disciples to do. Think about this. He knows he's about to go through the most excruciating experience that will ever be endured by a human being. He knows it's on the other side. And so he's got his team with them, right? If we're sticking with the sports analogy, he's got his team. He brings them to the garden of pressure. And he gathers them up and he says, all right, here's what I need you guys to do. I need you guys, this is go time, all right? This is when it gets real, right? We're going to play the clock now. We're a no-huddle offense now. Okay, here's what I need you to do, all right? You ready? Ready? I need you to sit. I need you to sit. Oh, and while you're sitting, I need you to keep watch. I need you to watch that. Oh, and while you're sitting and keeping watch, I also want you to just stay awake. Can you do me that much? Can you just wake up? Ask my wife around 9 o'clock. I can't do that. I just fall asleep. And I want you to pray. I want you to sit. I want you to wake up. I want you to keep watch. And I want you to pray. I hope you hear the freedom and permission in that moment. When Jesus is feeling the greatest pressure that he has ever felt, he doesn't call his disciples to panic. He doesn't call his disciples to argument or division. He doesn't call them to do anything great in the eyes of what greatness appears. He calls them to sit, wake up, pray, keep watch. In the moments of pressure, God calls us, Jesus calls us to the work of prayer. And the work of prayer is a work that resists busyness and a rest that refuses laziness. It is a work that refuses the busyness of the world, and it's also a rest that refuses the laziness. When Jesus was being pressed and pushed, when the pressure was at his greatest, his call to his people then and to us today was to slow down. It would be so easy to panic right now. It would be so easy to get on Facebook and solve all the world's problems and no, slow down. He says, I want you to keep watch. I want you to be alert to what's happening around you. He says, I want you to wake up. Wake up from apathy. Wake up from the things that have been lulling us to sleep. And I want you to pray. And I want you to press into God. Now, I want you to think about Jesus' prayer because it's super simple. Like it's so simple, even I can pray it. I think one of our maybe challenges with prayer is sometimes we think we got to have these big words or these fancy words. We got to do this or do that. You got to know all of this or not. Listen to this: is the King of Kings and Lord of Lords prayer. This is Jesus' prayer. Listen to what he prays. Begin in verse 39. He says, "My Father, if it's possible, let this cup pass from me, nevertheless, not as I will, but as you will." And then again in verse 42, he says, "My Father, if this cannot pass until I drink it, your will be done." His prayer, it's very, and he does it a third time, but we don't get the specific words. We just said he prays something similarly. But the prayer is essentially, "Father, if it's possible, if there's any other way around about what's going to happen, let's do that. But if not, your will, not my will, be done." And then the second time he says, "If it's just not possible, your will, not my will, be done." It's subtle, but I think there's two different prayers there. And I think we need to be praying both of them. It's subtle, but I think there's two different prayers there, and we need to be praying both of them. The first prayer is this: "God, save me from this. God, save me from this. Father, if it's possible, if there is another way," and church, I want you all to hear this, there was another way. It might not work. It might not be effective. But there were options on the table. Do you remember when Jesus was tempted in the wilderness? Do you remember the third temptation when the devil takes him up on a high place? He said, "Look, man, look as far as you can see. I'll give it to you. I'll give you all of this, and there won't be a cross. You can do whatever you want with it. I'll give it all to you. If there won't be a cross." There were other options on the table. But just because there's other options on the table doesn't mean they're effective. And so look what Jesus does. He says, "Father," look who he's talking to. Who we talk to matters, right? Who we get our advice from matters, right? Who we go to for information. I'm not just talking about stuff and facts. I'm not talking about information. I'm talking about inner formation. Who we go to for inner formation matters. So here in this moment, in the garden, in the pressing, when the pressure's coming down, he's not talking to the devil. He's not talking to the serpent. We saw how that worked in the Garden of Eden. It didn't work out great. So he says, "Father," he goes to his Father in prayer, "if there is another way, a way that will actually work, let's consider that. But if not, your will be done. Father, save me from this if it's possible. Save me from it." Now check out the second time he prays. Like I said, subtle, but I think it's there. He goes from, "Father, if it's possible, you know, your will be, you know, if it's possible to save me from this, let's do that. Nevertheless, your will, not mine." The second time, he drops off the "Father, if it's possible" part. Did you notice that? All he says, "If it's not possible, if there's no other way, I'm still in. It's subtle, but you know what I think he's saying? I think the movement is from "save me from" to "save me for this." Not "save me from," but "save me for this." Lord, if there is no other way, save me for this moment. Give me the strength, give me the courage, give me the faithfulness, give me the endurance, give me the patience, give me love, give me the conviction. Lord, I don't want to back away from this moment. I don't want to miss the moment that you're calling me into. If you can't save me from it, then please, Lord, save me for it. In church, if we were going to be really honest, I won't put this on you, but I'll put this on me. In my life, I think I've gotten really good at "God, save me from." I'm not so sure I pray very often, "Lord, save me for this moment. God, get me out of this. Get me out of this financial situation. Get me out of this sickness. Get me out of this. Lord, get me out of this COVID stuff. Get me." Look, there is nothing wrong with praying, "Save me from." Jesus prayed it. The only problem is when we are so attuned to praying, "Save me from," that we never move to say, to pray, "Save me for this moment." Dear Lake, I want to be a church that's praying both, because Jesus prayed both, and I want us to be a Jesus church, amen? That means we pray both. We say, Lord, please save us from this. But at the same time, we say, but Lord, if it's not possible, if the only way through this is through this, if there's no getting around, if there's no plan B, if there's no other option, then Lord, save me for this moment. Stir up my strength. Stir up my conviction. Stir up my compassion. Stir up my faithfulness. Stir up whatever I need in this moment to be as faithful to you and make you known in the world in this moment. Because if there's no getting around it and there's only going through it, I want to go through it in such a way that honors you, King Jesus. It's not just save me from, it's save me for. Jesus prayed both. In that moment of pressing and pressure, he prayed both, and he invites us to do the same, to sit, to slow down, to keep watch, to take note of what's happening around us, to wake up. Now, there have been plenty of times when I felt like during this whole last 6 or 7 months where I'm like, I just want to go to sleep and wake me up when it's over. And that might work for some people, but not Jesus people. Because Jesus people pray not just save me from, but to save me for. Let's pray both, amen. I want to leave you with three things just to do on your own time, okay? One of the things that's really I've been really convicted about through this whole pandemic experience is we try to figure out everything in this moment, and then what we end up doing is we just wait for the next moment, right? It's like we got it all now and we're good, and then we'll wait till next Sunday to do it all over again. I don't want us to do that. I don't want us to be that. So I'm going to give you three things that you can think about and wrestle with on your own time. And so my challenge to you is to pick one of them. My challenge to you is pick one of them, wrestle with it, explore it more, and see where the Lord takes you, okay? So these are some things I think we learn from the scripture here about prayer specifically. And the first thing is this. Prayer does not spare us from pain, but it prepares and sustains us for it. Prayer does not spare us from pain and suffering. It actually prepares and sustains us for us. Jesus actually goes in there and says, Lord, if it's possible, get me out of this. And the end result for Jesus was still that he went through that. Some of us have this idea that when we pray or if we commit ourselves to God or anything like that, that everything's supposed to be smooth sailing. It wasn't for Jesus. And if we're going to follow him, we can't expect the same. We can expect the same. So that might be an area to explore. What does it mean that prayer doesn't spare us from pain and suffering, but it actually prepares us for it? If you want to look at Matthew 26, look how different Jesus is on the other side of Gethsemane. Luke's gospel, I believe, actually tells us that he's sweating blood, or maybe it's just one of the other gospels tells us that he's sweating blood during this time. He's in agony. He's hurting. This is a battle in of itself. But he's not backing down. He's not backing down. Comes out very, very different. The second thing that I would encourage you to consider is that in prayer, it's not about getting God to conform to us, but it's us conforming to God. How did Jesus end all his prayers? Nevertheless, not my will, but yours be done. If we pray with the expectation that whatever's supposed to happen here is God's supposed to line up with my behavior, my expectation, and desire, very often we're going to leave incredibly disappointed. But let me tell you, Jesus did not leave disappointed. He left strengthened and sustained for the challenge at hand, because prayer, it's not about God conforming to us, but us conforming to God. And finally, the third thing, if you want to check this out, the primary purpose of prayer is intimacy with God. The primary purpose of prayer is intimacy with God. In Luke's gospel in chapter 22, it says that Jesus went to the Mount of Olives as usual. As usual. You ever wondered how did Judas know where to find him if Judas had already left? Judas was smart. He knew exactly where to look for Jesus because Jesus had a prayer habit. He had a system, had a ritual, had a rhythm, a pattern of prayer. Jesus' life wasn't always this kind of pressure, but he knew he always needed this kind of prayer life. And so even when he wasn't facing this kind of pressure, it was not out of character for him to go to the place of pressing to press into prayer. And when we look at it that way, we realize it's not about getting God to do anything specific. It's about just being with the Father. There's a story about two boys whose father's a king. Father's a king, very, very busy, and so he doesn't have a lot of time for them. And so once a week, he invites them to come spend some time with him. And every time he comes, he has a gift for them. There's two boys, right? Well, the one son would come in and he'd see the gift on the table and he'd run and he'd open it up and whatever it was, he'd get so excited, then he'd bolt outside to go play with it. The other son was different. He'd come in and see the gift and pull up a chair next to his dad and they'd start talking. They'd talk about their adventures in the kingdom, the battles they'd fought, the adventures they'd had. And before they knew it, hours had gone by, and the father would say, son, I've so enjoyed this time with you, but I'm so sorry if the kingdom calls and I've got to get back to work. And the son would, I know, it's okay. And so he'd begin to leave, and the father would say, oh, son, your gift. He'd have to be reminded to take whatever the thing was, you see, for the son. The gift was time with the father. And that's kind of what it means to pray, save me for this moment. God, we need more of God in our lives, amen? We need more of the presence and power of Jesus in our lives, amen? We need to pray both these things, God, save me from, and God, save me for. And so if any of those things would be an encouragement to you, to dig into knowing that prayer doesn't spare us, it sustains us, that it's about conforming to God, not God conforming to us, and that ultimately it's about intimacy with God. Y'all, the world is crazy right now. Florida State's 0-2, okay? I mean, crazy. Who'd have thought? I'm just way crazier than that, right? Way crazier than that. But when the world gets crazy, when the pressure kicks up, God's people press into prayer, amen? Let's pray together. Would you stand with me? Let's pray. And if this is weird, you don't have to do it. And if it is weird and you want to do it, you can. But I'm just going to ask you to extend your hands like this. And we're going to pray over our city. We're going to pray over our schools. We're going to pray over our families right here. And so let's pray in the name of Jesus that not only would we'd be people saved from something, but we'd be a people saved for something. That the power of God would be unleashed in us and through us for the sake of the whole world. And so, Heavenly Father, if it's possible, if there are other ways for doing what we're doing, God, then we are open to whatever your will is, God. But if it's not, if the only way through this way is through it, God, that we surrender wholeheartedly to who you are and who you've called us to be. God, would you save us for this moment? Would you strengthen and empower us with your love and grace and mercy and compassion? God, would we find ourselves in places amongst people who are in desperate need of your love, and may the power of your Spirit, God, pour out from us wherever we're at and whoever we are with. Thank you, Lord, for sending your son Jesus to be for us what we could not be for ourselves. And now, Lord, through your power and presence, would you save us for this moment so that we might be a people set apart for such a time as this. We love you and we bless you all. Honor and glory and power is yours. In the name of Jesus, we pray. Amen.
Come on, we're going to sing this, I believe. We're going to sing Our Father.
And Our Father everlasting, the all-creating one, God Almighty. And through your Holy Spirit, conceiving Christ the Son, Jesus, our Savior.
Come on, we sing.
I believe in God, our Father. I believe in Christ, the Son. I believe in the Holy Spirit. Our God is three in one. I believe in the resurrection, that we will rise again. For I believe
sing our judge.
And our judge and our defender, suffered and crucified. Forgiveness is in you. Descended into darkness, you rose in glorious light. Forever seated high.
Come on, we sing because we believe.
I believe in God our Father. I believe in Christ the Son. I believe in the Holy Spirit. Our God is three in one. I believe in the resurrection, that we will rise again. For I believe in the name of Jesus.
Come on, I believe.
Inside. Jesus Christ is Lord.
Come on, we sing it again.
And I believe in you. I believe you rose again. And I believe that Jesus Christ is Lord.
Come on, if you feel led to do so, just lift your hands in the air when we sing this again. Come on, lift your voice.
I believe in God our Father. I believe in Christ the Son. I believe in the Holy Spirit. Our God is three in one. I believe in the resurrection, that we will rise again. For I believe in the name of Jesus. I believe in God our Father. I believe in Christ the Son. I believe in the Holy Spirit. Our God is three in one. I believe in the resurrection, that we will rise again. For I believe
Jay. Well, as we get ready to leave from this place, I want to remind you of a couple of announcements to let you know that there is a ramp build on October 3rd. And next Sunday, October 4th, we will be having Communion Sunday. So I hope that you will bring your communion supplies. We will have some available if you forget. And then last, to say that if you are watching us online, that you can give safely and securely on through our website. And as we go from this place, I want to remind you of Bobby's three challenges, is to remember that prayer doesn't spare us from pain, but it prepares us for it. That prayer isn't about us getting God to conform to us, but instead us conforming to God's will. And then lastly, that prayer prepares us for a more intimate relationship with God. So, Father, we thank you for gathering us, and we pray as you send us out, Lord, that we will just continue to press into you through prayer. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Go in peace.